In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening. It is such a privilege to do Bible class, and I'm grateful to God for it. So, as usual, it's Wednesday, 7 p.m. So, welcome aboard this wondrous journey as we head into Matthew's Gospel, chapter 10. Today we shall see how Jesus chose his 12 apostles, and we will get acquainted with each one of them. Then we will see how he trained them. And third, we will see how he sent them out into the field. And fourth, how he predicted the persecution they would face when they were sent out for the first time, and also after his ascension into heaven. In chapter 10, Matthew writes how Jesus chose his team of 12 apostles and how he mentored them to go on a mission. In the beginning, Jesus labored single-handedly. His miracles were confined to Galilee. But as the work of the kingdom grew, Jesus would require organization and division of labor. He was aware that he was going to die in a short period. There had to be some people in whose hands he would be delegating his mission. Many of us think he casually selected the 12. No. First, he asked them to follow him. They were not staying with him. They would join him on and off, you know. So he had to choose a team from among his countless disciples. When he chose the 12, he had a little more than 18 months to train them for the monumental job at hand. It was his wish that these selected men should be with them at all times, in all places, witnessing all his work and ministering to his daily needs. There was no second string, no B team, no backup, no plan B if the 12 should fail. Can you imagine the scene if the 12 had failed? Just imagine. The apostles he chose were ordinary men, like us. They were Jews, uneducated commoners, full of flaws and weaknesses, and simple men of faith who gave up everything to be followers of Christ. Jesus spent many months training these men to be leaders. Jesus' plan was, after he died, these men would take over and carry on the good work that he had started. They were mostly fishermen and not wealthy. So why did Jesus choose them? Jesus chose them not only for what they were, but for what they were capable of becoming under his leadership, under his influence and power as well. So if you think we are nothing, we have hope in Jesus. If we are with Jesus, I'm sure we too will do well in our lives. Far from being perfect, these men were full of flaws, were weak of faith, and faced bitter failure, no more so than Peter, their leader. Jesus even remarked that they were slow learners and spiritually dense in Luke chapter 24, verse 25. But yet he chose them. He knew all their faults all along. He even knew that Judas would betray him, and yet did not discriminate against him. You might ask, how come Jesus, in spite of knowing that Judas would eventually betray him, did not take any precautions? How could Jesus interact amiably with a man who was going to get him killed? Well, Judas's betrayal was God's plan to fulfill Jesus' passion and death and resurrection. Well, Jesus was God incarnate, fully God and fully man. He never used his divine powers for himself. If he had used it, his passion, death and resurrection would have no meaning at all. If God's Son could suffer, we have no reason to complain when we suffer. Suffering is inevitable for all of us, because in the end, all of us are going to go, we are all going to die. You know, I have told this before, but I keep on reiterating it in many of my Bible classes. I say this, you know, that when you were born, when you were a little baby, the angel of the Lord came and kept something in your palm, in your tight, your fist was tight. He kept something there. You know what it was? It was your return ticket. I hope you've not lost it. Return ticket to go back. All of us are going to go back. So suffering is inevitable for all of us, because in the end, all of us are going to die. We are in transit here on earth. We have to get off someday, for our destination is with God in heaven. Well, the word apostles comes from apostolai in Greek, which means messengers or sent ones. They were to be ambassadors for Christ and would be given supernatural powers to work signs and wonders. You can see it in the various verses in the Bible. Their role actually involved leadership and exclusive teaching authority in the early church. People would listen to them. It was spiritual, that role. They were to be the foundation of the church. Now you might ask, why 12 apostles? Why 12? Well, the 12, you know, the 12 tribes of Israel. And anyway, 12 is a number that denotes fullness. Jesus' strategy of founding the church and the spread of the good news depended entirely on those 12 ordinary men. The risk was great. So before Jesus chose them, he prayed. You can read that in Luke chapter 6, verses 12 and 13. It was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray, and he spent the whole night in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also named apostles. This 2000 year triumph of the apostles is a testimony of the power of the Holy Spirit. Those 12 ordinary men took Jesus' teachings to the ends of the earth. They were truly the pillars of our church. You know, today management gurus are taking cues from Jesus' selection methods. Jesus took 12 of the most disparate and ordinary people and trained and empowered them to change the world forever after his departure. You know, management gurus are looking at the team building synergies that don't make 1 plus 1 equal to 2, but 1 plus 1 equal to 11. The sum of the apostles after Jesus left was not 12, but exponentially high, thanks to the Holy Spirit. Well, let's start reading. Jesus sends up the 12. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. You know, in those days, medical science was primitive. Cures for diseases were elusive. People were suffering not only from disease, but also from the stigma of being labeled as sinners. Jesus wanted his apostles to show people the kingdom of God. Selection of the 12 apostles. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Simon, the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Let's start from the first apostle, their leader. He was also known as Simon or Cephas. Rock means rock. Peter was a gregarious fellow, natural leader and an obvious spokesperson for the 12. Peter's name occurs far more in the New Testament than any of the other disciples. Let me tell you beforehand, before I go any further, that these observations are from when Jesus first met them. They are not, you know, after the time when they were blessed by the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. This was before. Okay? Peter was very impulsive and had a lot of energy. He often spoke without thinking and he acted without thinking. He was aggressive and cocky. But that would change dramatically when he was challenged. He would suddenly become from a hero to a zero, a coward, and he denied Jesus. But one thing was for sure, he loved our Lord immensely. He was the older of the two brothers and the only married disciple. You can refer that to that in Luke 4, when Jesus went to his house and healed his mother-in-law. And his wife was also known to travel with him when he was on mission in the later years. You can read that in 1 Corinthians. His assignment was to bring the gospel to the circumcised. Peter is well known for denying Jesus 3 times after his arrest. You know, but very strangely, we humans always look at a person's faults, not his goodness. We will constantly be looking at their faults. You know, it's like, for example, we look at Peter's denying Jesus. We look at Thomas doubting Jesus. But we never look at their positive points. Yeah, we must give up this habit. Yeah. Now, after his own arrest many years later, Peter requested to be crucified with his head down. He didn't believe he was worthy to be crucified in the same manner as his Lord. He died a martyr's death in Rome during the reign of Nero, about around the same time as Paul was being beheaded. So that's Peter. Let's go to the second apostle. The second is Andrew. Andrew was an early disciple of John the Baptist. Andrew and John, that is the son of Zebedee, were present when John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God," when Jesus was coming. So they were present there and they heard. Andrew was the first to follow Jesus and his enthusiasm was evident. He introduced his older brother, Peter, to Jesus. He was not a dominant person like his outspoken brother, Peter. He was friendly and approachable, and he shared the gospel boldly and was a significant contributor to the early church. Andrew died a martyr's death. He faced crucifixion with boldness and courage. So Peter and Andrew were born in Bethsaida, being brothers, of course. They settled in Capernaum. They were fishermen and worked alongside James and John, who were their companions for years. Peter and Andrew, of course, were early followers of John the Baptist, but they left John and followed Christ. Next, we come to James. Well, James is the elder brother of John. He was a rather quiet but passionate and fiery fellow. As part of Jesus' inner three, he was present along with Peter and John when Jesus raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. He also witnessed Jesus' transfiguration on the Mount of Olives. And he was in the Garden of Gethsemane with Jesus. James was the first disciple to be martyred. He was beheaded and the only apostle to have their martyrdom recorded in scripture in the book of Acts chapter 12. Next we come to John. John, the disciple Jesus loved. That's always what John introduced himself as. He was a part of the inner three again. He wrote a large portion of the New Testament. The Gospel of John and the books of John 1, 2 and 3. And some say he also wrote the book of Revelation. He wrote more about love than any other New Testament author. His close proximity to Jesus taught him much about love. The Gospel of John is also known as the Sacramental Gospel. John was exiled to the island of Patmos under Domitian, Caesar of Rome. But after his death, John was allowed to return to Ephesus, where he governed churches in Asia until his death at about AD 100. So that's John for you. James and John were sons of Zebedee. There is some evidence that Zebedee was a rich man. He was able to hire enough servants to help with his fishing business. You can read that in Mark chapter 1 verse 20. James is quieter than his younger brother John. He's somewhat obscure even though he is part of Jesus' inner three. John is much more in the forefront during his discipleship. James and John were ambitious and both known for being men of intense passion and fervor. Because of this, Jesus named them sons of thunder or Boanerges. And now next up, of course, is Philip. Philip was a Jew, but we only know him by his Greek name. He was the one who told Nathanael the Messiah had been found. Philip was from Bethsaida, just like Peter and Andrew. And he was Andrew's friend. He was mathematically inclined. In John chapter 6, Jesus asked him, from among all the apostles, Jesus asked him where to buy bread for the crowd of 5,000. And Philip mentally calculated it would cost half a year's wages. Philip, after his mission, was stoned and crucified in Hierapolis in Phrygia, which is somewhere in modern-day Turkey. Next up, we've got Bartholomew or Nathanael. He was from Cana in Galilee, but he was prejudiced against Nazareth. It happens to a lot of us. A guy from one state in India will not like another guy from another state. So he was prejudiced against Nazareth. In John chapter 1, verse 46, you can hear. Can anything good come out of Nazareth when Philip was telling about Jesus? Jesus must have heard it, but you know, Jesus did not notice his prejudice, but Jesus noticed his genuine love for God and said, "Behold an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Because Jesus saw him praying under the fig tree. Of course, Bartholomew was beaten, crucified, and beheaded. He died as a martyr while serving in Albinopolis in Armenia. Next, we have Thomas, known as the twin, or Didymus in Greek. Although there is no mention of his twin brother or sister in the Bible, he's still called the twin. He's unfairly called Doubting Thomas because he was the one always asking the important questions. He refused to have blind faith. He wanted answers, and that's a good thing. That's why we're here at Bible class. In John chapter 14, Jesus said, you know, he was talking to his apostles, and he said, "You know the way to the place where I am going." Jesus, you know, was not talking any geographical place. He was talking of heaven, and he said, the way is the narrow way. You know, the way you got to be close to God and in His grace. That you know the way to the place where I am going. So he had already told them that, but Thomas took it as a geographical place, and as well as all the other apostles. So, but no one but Thomas asked, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" In John chapter 11, Lazarus is dead in Bethany, all right? Where Jesus' life is in danger in Bethany. But we can see Thomas's courage, bravery, and loyalty to Jesus when he says, "Let us also go that we may die with him." And then finally in John chapter 20, verse 28, we read about Thomas's love for Jesus and his desire to see and touch before he believed, and then his declaration when he put his finger inside Jesus' wounds, "My Lord and my God." Thomas started the church in India. He was killed by a spear. That's what they say. Next up, you know about him, Matthew, Levi, who was a tax collector. The most despised people in Israel were tax collectors. They collected taxes for the Romans and forced the poor to pay bribes to pad their own pockets. But Matthew left everything except his pen and followed Jesus. He was one apostle who could write. He wrote the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus did not see Matthew the way the Jews saw him. Yeah. Matthew brought the gospel to Ethiopia and Egypt. Hyrcanus the king had him killed with a spear. Next up, we've got James the younger. But he was also called James the less, probably because he was the youngest. He is the son of Alphaeus in the book of Luke chapter 6, that's mentioned. His mother's name is Mary. That also we come to know because Mark has written that in chapter 15. And he has a brother named Joseph. Matthew writes that in chapter 27. He is referred to as James the Less in Mark chapter 15. Because to distinguish him from James the brother of John. He was trained and used by Jesus in a powerful way to further the kingdom of God. Tradition says he was crucified in Sinai or possibly stoned to death in Jerusalem. Now we come to Judas, not Iscariot, but Judas Thaddeus. He is also called Jude. In John chapter 14, Jude asked, that's the only time I think he spoke and has been recorded in the scripture. He asked Jesus, "Lord, why are you going to reveal yourself only to us and not to the world at large?" Judas seemed overly concerned with this question. He wanted to share his Lord with the world. Christ responded that he would reveal himself to anyone who loved him. Most early tradition says that a few years after Pentecost, he took the gospel not to Edessa. There he healed the king of Edessa, Abgar. The traditional symbol of Judas Thaddeus is a club because he was clubbed to death for his faith. Simon the Zealot, or Simon the Zealot, was a political extremist. Why would Jesus choose someone with this background? It is amazing that Jesus would select a man like Simon to be his apostle. Incredibly, Had Simon the Zealot come across Matthew the tax collector alone, he would have surely assassinated him. Such was his zeal for Israel. He was what we would call today a terrorist. Simon the Zealot was a man of fierce loyalties, amazing passion, courage and zeal. Simon had believed the truth and embraced Christ as his Lord. The fiery enthusiasm he once had for Israel was now expressed in his devotion to Christ. Tradition says that after preaching on the west coast of Africa, Simon went to England, where he ended up being crucified in AD 74. Last but not the least, Judas Iscariot, the traitor. His encounter and call by Jesus is not recorded in scripture. So where Jesus called him and how he came to be in the 12, that is not recorded. He was not from Galilee, that much is known. He was not from Galilee. He obviously became a follower and stayed with Jesus for 3 years. He gave Jesus 3 years of his life, but he certainly didn't give him his heart. And Jesus knew this. Judas betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Judas was probably disillusioned when he realized that Jesus' kingdom was not of this world. His love for money had made him very ambitious. But after betraying Jesus, he was so full of guilt that he hanged himself. Judas stands as a warning about the evil potential of spiritual carelessness, squandered opportunity, sinful lust, and a hardness of the heart. Here was a man who drew as close to the Savior as it is humanly possible to be. He enjoyed every privilege that Christ affords, and he was intimately familiar with everything Jesus taught. Yet he remained in unbelief and went into a hopeless eternity. Had we been so close to Jesus, we would have been blessed. But sadly for Judas. You know, I want to tell you about the apostles. This is a wonderful book written by John of Macatha, and he says in his book, 12 Ordinary Men, the apostles were trained for a time that is best measured in months, not years. Jesus taught them scriptures and theology. Jesus showed them how to pray, to forgive, to serve one another with humility. He gave them moral instructions. He spoke to them of things to come. And he employed them as his instruments to heal the sick, cast out demons, and do miraculous works. But it was a brief but intensive schedule of discipleship. And when it was over on the night of Jesus' betrayal, all the disciples forsook him and fled. You can read that in Matthew chapter 26, verse 56. From an earthly point of view, the training program looked like a monumental failure. It seemed the disciples had forgotten or ignored everything that Jesus had taught them about taking up the cross and following him. In fact, their own sense of failure was so profound that they went back to their old vocations for a time. And even at that, it appeared they would fail. You can read that in John chapter 21. But, encouraged by the risen Lord, they returned. And empowered by the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, they valiantly undertook the task to which Jesus had called them. The work they subsequently began continues even today, 2,000 years later. They are living proof that God's strength is made perfect in weakness. So I want to tell you, never give up. The Lord is with us. You could read from verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. When you read this, you start thinking, but why did Jesus say then, do not go to the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans? Does he have something against them? No, there were many reasons for that. First, what Jesus meant was that since they were only 12 and since time was short, they should restrict themselves to Galilee. Number two, the apostles would be culturally uncomfortable with the Gentiles and with the Samaritans. They were not equipped to preach to them. Number three, the message has little chance of success if the messenger is ill-equipped to deliver it. The apostles were not equipped culturally to handle non-Jews. And last, remember, this command of Jesus was just temporary one. It was not a permanent command. So then we will read verses 6 and 7. So Jesus told them, go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. And as you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. They had not only to speak, but also to do in deeds. The Lord has given you and given all of us His talents freely. We have to use them to help others for free. Then Jesus said, do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. They used to carry it in their belt. You know? It was a folded cloth belt. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff for the worker is worth his keep. God's messengers must trust that God will take care of them and their needs. Jesus tells them not to provide for their boarding, for the worker is worth his keep, because their work will be worth board and lodging to those they come to. They will give it to them because they are worth it. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. And if not, let your peace return to you. You know, Jesus told them not to indiscriminately choose any house to stay, because he wanted them to stay there till the end. Jesus said, if the home was not deserving, the apostle must not let his peace be taken from him. He must let his peace come back to him. You know what happens is many times if somebody insults us, our peace is disturbed. It's taken away from us. Yeah. So what Jesus is saying, if somebody insults you, if that house is not deserving, let your peace return to you. Let your peace return to you. Just be calm. Be peaceful. Let it come back to you. That's what Jesus is saying. We read from verse 14. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. Why is Jesus saying that? Please don't carry all that baggage in your head. Many of us are carrying a lot of baggage. You know, somebody gives us a tokra of bad words and all, we are carrying that tokra all our lives. Okay, forget. Just shake the dust off your feet. The Jews would normally shake the dust off their feet when returning from Gentile or hostile territory. Truly, I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. Why is Jesus saying this? Why is Jesus talking like this? Why will it be worse for the town than it was for Sodom and Gomorrah? God's messengers had visited Sodom and Gomorrah not with any redemptive message. They had only gone there to take Lot out of the place. And they were ill-treated. But Jesus' apostles would be taking the message of salvation to the towns. So the punishment for ignoring them would be greater. Jesus would not be punishing them. They would be punishing themselves. Then Jesus says, I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. When Jesus sent out his men for the first time, he told them what to expect. Straight off. The apostles were simple people. They stood no chance against the wicked and selfish scribes and Pharisees who were a more sophisticated lot. So they had to take care. Then Jesus says, I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore be as shrewd as snakes and innocent as doves. Why is Jesus, is he telling them to be like snakes? Let's have a look at that. See, every living creature here on earth has got both good and evil traits. Jesus is not telling his apostles to be like snakes. He's telling them to just use the snake's best trait of survival. That is the snake's shrewdness, and yet to remain innocent as doves. Because to survive with those Pharisees, you had to be very shrewd. But one thing I want to tell you before I go further into the next part, which is so confusing. You see, we have already seen how Matthew is so organized. In chapters 5 to 7, he gathered all of Jesus' sermons on the Mount given across 3 years. And he wrote it there in these three chapters. Because chapter 8 contained all his, most of his miracles, 7 miracles, you saw that. And in chapter 9, he listed the Pharisaic opposition to Jesus over 3 years. He quoted it in chapter 9. The following verses that occur now, I'm going to read it, contain quotes that Matthew collects from different times. Here he collects the things which Jesus said on various occasions about persecution. From before his resurrection, that is now, until his resurrection, death and resurrection, to after his resurrection. So let us see it in context. Jesus had told the apostles not to go beyond Galilee, right? And yet in this passage, Matthew shows us Jesus foretelling persecution and trial before rulers and kings, that is to say, far beyond Palestine. The apostles are not going to go beyond Galilee. But here Jesus is warning them that there will be persecution far beyond Palestine. So it is clear that Matthew is not only telling us what Jesus said when he sent his men out for the first time, but he had also added what Jesus told them after his resurrection when he was sending them out into all the world. Right? So let's read now. Be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. Jesus is predicting the persecution that the apostles will face after he is gone. But when they arrest you, do not worry what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say. For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of the Father speaking through you. See, Jesus is predicting the power of the Holy Spirit. It's amazing. I'm telling you, many times during Bible class, I think I've told this to you before. The class is to grow, is going on a very good note, and suddenly somebody asks a very pertinent question in context, relating to the context of what is being taught. And sometimes I don't know the answer. When I don't know the answer, I say I don't know. Sometimes the question is so important that it needs to be answered. So I start praying to the Holy Spirit. When the question is thrown at me, I look at the person, but I am internally praying to the Holy Spirit to help me. And believe me, what comes out of my mouth is not from my mind or from my knowledge. I give the correct answer, and then I wonder, how did I answer it? I did not know the answer. That is the Holy Spirit. For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Let's read further. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. You will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. You see, what Jesus is telling them is, after he goes back, his ascension into heaven, the family would persecute them. Their nearest and dearest would think them mad and shut the door against them. They would be confronted with the hardest choice of all, the choice between Jesus Christ and family. So then Jesus says, when you are persecuted in one place, flee to another. Truly I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Now what is this? Jesus is asking you to flee. Many people, you know, will say, oh, Jesus is asking you to be a coward. No, not at all. See, in the days of persecution, there are always those who will actually court martyrdom. I want to be shaheed. I want to give my life to God. Many people in those days, and even today, they go out of their way to become martyrs. What good is a dead martyr if you're not going to be able to do anything for your country? Don't give away your life for no reason. Jesus was wise. He told his men that there must be no wastage of Christian lives, that they must not pointlessly and needlessly throw their lives away. Bravado is not martyrdom. Often the Christians had to die for their faith. Yes, they had to die for their faith. They would die. They would become martyrs. But they must not throw away their lives if it did not help their faith. If it did not help the faith. While we are bound to accept martyrdom for our faith, we are forbidden to court martyrdom. We can't say, "Ah, bhai, mere ko maar. Come, kill me. You can't do that. Can't be a जबरदस्ती का मार्टर. इफ सफरिंग फॉर द फेथ कम्स टू अस इन लाइफ इट मस्ट बी एक्सेप्टेड बट इट मस्ट नॉट बी नीडलेसली इन्वाइटेड. सो मेनी पीपल दे आर बिकमिंग ह्यूमन बॉम्ब्स यू नो. दे स्ट्रैप देमसेल्व्स विद एक्सप्लोसिव्स एंड ब्लो देमसेल्व्स अप. दैट्स नॉट मार्टिरडम. Then Jesus says, truly I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. You know, many people think that this is eschatological, that is after the end of the world. Actually, Jesus is telling them that he will join them before they finish the tour of Galilee. This tour of Galilee. Now he's come back here. He's sending them into Galilee. No, he says that he'll catch up with them. That's what Jesus is saying. Yeah, so let's not confuse it. We'll read next. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebul, how much more the members of his household? They have dared to call Jesus Beelzebul. If they can dare to call Jesus that, you think they will spare his apostles and his disciples? It is Jesus' warning to his disciples that they must expect what happened to him to happen to them. If the Pharisees could call Jesus Beelzebul, then how much more the members of his household would be troubled. So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. You know, three times in this short passage, Jesus bids his disciples not to be afraid. In the king's messenger, there must be a certain courageous fearlessness which marks him out from other men. They were all king's messengers when they were sent out to Galilee. What is the meaning of this? There is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be made known. The meaning of this is that truth will triumph. It will not be hidden. It will triumph and be made open. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth much more than many sparrows. You know, the body was meant to be temporary anyway. I told you about your return ticket. So do not be afraid of those who kill the body. But beware of God who can destroy both your body and your soul in hell. Since God takes care of even sparrows that cost nothing, God will surely take care of you. But you have to be on his side. Then Jesus says, whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. Do not suppose I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Jesus is telling them up front, without any sugarcoating, the cost of discipleship. If you think God is less worthy than someone else to whom you are afraid to acknowledge God, then you shall be left orphan, sadly. How will you be able to plead for God's mercy when you are in trouble? Will you go to that man? Will that man before whom you have refused to acknowledge God, will he be able to help you? For I have come to turn man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against a mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. This is Jesus' prediction in the future. And it happened in Rome. The early Christians in Rome, during the times of the early church, there was so much strife and someone embraced Christianity that families were torn apart. Then we read, anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it. And whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. If you love God more than anything else, you will be able to love the whole world. You will be able to love your father, mother, brother, sister, everybody. Daughter, son. But if you love God less, your love for anyone else will be fickle. And I already told you about the eternal world and the temporal world. Whoever finds their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. Now we come to the next part. Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me. Anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. Whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. Anyone who welcomes you for doing God's work is actually welcoming God. He will be blessed. That's what it said. Yeah. We go to the last part. If anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward. What is the meaning of this? Little ones? See, giving a cup of water is the least one can do. Whenever somebody comes home, you can at least give them a cup of water, right? That's the easiest thing one can do. Jesus is saying, if anyone even gives a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple. Little ones? Who are these little ones? Little ones in age? No. Little ones in caliber. Little ones in faith. Little ones who have just started out as apostles. You know? So if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to any one of these, to one of these little ones, who is my disciple? Because these disciples were going out and they were raw. That's why Jesus is saying that. Truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward. I want to tell you a story. Yeah. About a cobbler and the preacher. Look, there were two young boys, they were great friends. One of the boys was from a poor family, his father was a cobbler. And the other boy came from a rich family, an affluent family, and both of them had one great hobby. They used to read and try to understand the Bible together. As they grew up, the poor boy couldn't afford to go to school and he became a cobbler like his father. But his friend rose up the ranks and finally became a preacher. He became a very famous preacher. The cobbler once went up to him and he said, you know, friend, from now on till the day I die, I will make all your shoes and I will mend them. He says, and I won't charge you for it. So the preacher said, why? He says, no, because I have the privilege to say that you preached in my shoes. You know, so that's how it is. You know, so you also, you know, like I have made this video. You can give me a little cup of water by commenting on this on this video, and also by recommending it to your friends. Yeah, because we are doing the work of God. You and me, we are all doing the work of God. So to summarize, what did we learn today? Today we saw how Jesus chose his 12 apostles and we will get and how we got acquainted with each one of them. We also saw how he trained them and how he sent them out into the field. And lastly, we saw how he predicted the persecution they would face when they were sent out for the first time, and also what persecution they would face after his ascension into heaven. So that's all, folks. That ends Matthew chapter 10. Until next Wednesday, 7 p.m. God bless. Praise God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Don't forget to like, subscribe, share, and comment. Thank you.